Good morning, everyone, and a very, very warm welcome to all of you for this grand finale of Pantomathics, the inter-school quiz contest presented by St. Kabir Public School. We are very glad to bring you this one-of-its-kind virtual quiz show organized by St. Kabir Public School, involving 19 of the brightest schools from the Chandigarh Tri-City area. We've had two fabulous semi-finals where some of these students representing their schools battled it out. And today we are here for the grand finale for the top 8 contestants of this quiz. To begin proceedings today, it is my pleasure and privilege to invite the man whose vision has made this quiz happen from St. Kabir Public School, Mr. Gurpreet Bakshi, to say a few words and welcome all of you and kick off this event. Over to you, Mr. Bakshi.
Thank you, Venkatesh. It's been a pleasure to see the semi-finals and how the kids have performed. And I'm sure it's been a very learning and an enriching experience for all the children. So congratulations to all the finalists and my gratitude to all the heads of schools who have sent their children and made this event a success. All the best for the day and may the best player win.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. And thank you for all your support and all your vision in making this quiz a reality and making it happen. Thank you very, very much. Let's begin with the grand finale of Pantomathics, the inter-school quiz contest brought to you by St. Kabir Public School in association with Nexus Consulting. We are based in Bangalore. We are a knowledge, research, content and quizzing company. We do several quiz shows for schools, colleges and corporates. Please look us up on our website and our social media handles for further information of quizzes and programs. Your quizmaster for today, that's me, Venki Srinivasan. I am the CEO, co-founder and chief quizmaster of Nexus Consulting, and it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you all to this quiz. Right, what are we playing for? We're playing for some fabulous prizes. There are certificates for all of you. There are trophies for the winners. There's a special trophy for the school. Remember, each of you is representing your school. We've had only one contestant per school from 19 select schools take part. Apart from that, there are 10,000 rupees or more worth cash prizes. The winner takes home 5,100, the runner-up 3,100 and the second runner-up 2,100. Okay, so time to meet the finalists. We've arranged you in alphabetical order. Finalist number one of Pantomathics 2020, Arav Verma, Strawberry Fields, Chandigarh. Arav, please introduce yourself.
Hi guys, good morning. I go to Strawberry Fields High School and I'm in grade 12 studying non-med. Thank you. Best of luck.
All the best, Arav. Contestant number 2 in today's final is Devanshu Setia from New Public School, Chandigarh.
Hello everyone. My name is Devanshu Setia. I'm from the New Public School. I'm from class 9th.
Class 9. Excellent. One of our younger contestants here. Welcome, Devanshu. Contestant number 3. Is Harish from Sacred Heart School, Moga.
Good morning, everyone. Myself, Harish Kumar. I'm a 12th class student of Humanities Group. And on the behalf of Sacred Heart School Management, I would like to thank St. Kabir Public School and Nexus Consultancy for giving us this great opportunity to learn once again. And wish you all the best of luck.
Very good. Welcome, Harish. Thank you for those warm wishes and all the very best to you. Let's move on to contestant number 4, our first lady contestant of today, Harnoor Kaur from Learning Paths Mohali.
Good morning everyone, I am Harnoor Kaur from Learning Paths School and I am from grade 11. I wish all of you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Harnoor, and welcome. Moving on to contestant number 5 is Harshit Singh from Stepping Stones, Chandigarh.
Good morning everybody, I am Harshit from class 12th, non-medical stream, Stepping Stones, Chandigarh. All the best to you all.
Welcome, Harshit, and all the best to you as well. Contestant number 6 is Ratandeep Singh Puar from Vivek High School, Chandigarh.
Good morning, everyone. I am Ratandeep Singh Puar of grade 9 at Vivek High School, Chandigarh. I wish the best luck to everybody. Thank you.
And all the best to you, Ratandeep, and welcome to the final. Our penultimate finalist for today is Sejal Trehan from Yadavindra Public School, Mohali.
Good morning, one and all. I'm Sejal Trehan from Yadavindra Public School, Mohali. And I'm in class 12th and I wish all of you all the very best.
Okay, all the best to you, Sejal. And our final contestant is from the hosting school, St. Kabir Public School, Chandigarh, Suvansh Mahajan.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Suvansh and I'm from St. Kavi Public School, Chandigarh. I'm currently studying in class 12 in the humanities stream, and I wish everyone the best of luck. Thank you.
Wonderful. So those are our top 8 wonderful finalists in Pantomathics 2020, the inaugural edition of the Inter-School Quiz Contest by St. Kabir Public School. This is how the quiz is going to work. The first round will go clockwise on infinite bounds. We will have a special round in between, one direct to each contestant. And then we have an anti-clockwise going on infinite bounds of another 12 questions. Right. So we are timing this at about 1.5 hours. We hope to finish by 12:30, 12:45 p.m. Right. So let's move straight into round number one. Round number one is our clockwise round. The rules are as follows. There are 12 questions. We will go clockwise starting with Arav. We have infinite bounds for plus 10, no negatives. Infinite bounds means the only assigned question of the round is the first question to Arav. Everything else will depend on who answers it. So if Devanshu answers the question, then the next question will go to Harish and so on and so forth. Any part points will be given at my discretion and complete answers will be revealed only after the quiz is complete. And as per instructions already given to you, we would like to see all of you with your hands in front of camera all the time. Play fair, play in the spirit of the game, have a lot of fun, enjoy yourselves, and let's hope to have a great quiz. Right, let's get Pantomathics 2020 final started with question number one going to Arav. An appropriate question to start. Today, as you might know, is November 22nd. This is a book titled 11-22-63 and refers to an important and tragic event on that date, which in this book, a time traveler tries to stop. The book was written by an author more known for writing horror stories. So look at the cover of the book also carefully. You can see a personality on the cover. The book was also made into a TV series, so it says now an 8-part television event. The title of the book is The Day That Changed the World, 11-22-63, which is 22nd of November 1963, exactly 57 years ago. So what happened on 11-22-63, which the time traveler in this book tries to stop? And who is the author? And as an additional clue, the author has a royal surname. Okay, so Arav, let's get started with a guess from you.
I would like to pass.
You don't want to make any guess on either on the author. You can just guess a surname. Which means royal, that is also fine.
Bond,
okay. And you don't want to make a guess on what happened on 11-22-63?
No.
All right. We will pass you then on to Devanshu.
Yeah, I don't know the author name exactly, but I know that on that day, John F. Kennedy was assassinated.
John F. Kennedy was assassinated. Okay, so that's what the time traveler is trying to stop. And you want to make a guess on the author's name? Like I said, it's a royal surname. No idea?
Yeah, no idea.
Okay, we will pass you on to Harish.
I think the incident is John F. Kennedy's assassination, but the name of the royal surname is Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, okay. Passing you on to Harnoor. We'll have to be a little quick on the pass. So, Harnoor, do you have a guess?
I don't have any idea about this.
All right. I'm going to pass you on to Harshit.
Sorry, sir. I don't have any idea on this.
All right. We'll pass you on to Ratandeep.
So, the event is the assassination of JFK, that is John F. Kennedy, and the author is Stephen King.
Perfect answer by Ratandeep. Absolutely correct. This is the assassination of the US President John F. Kennedy in Dallas. It was a very, very important event in American history. Many people say that world history could have been shaped differently if the young and dynamic John F. Kennedy had not been assassinated. And he was assassinated while he was traveling in a car. And that's the picture that you can see on the cover of the book as well. And that is what happened exactly 57 years ago on 22-11-1963. So we thought we should start with a question that references today's date itself. So 5 points to Devanshu for getting the John F. Kennedy part right, and the full 10 points to Ratandeep for getting both parts correct. Let's move to question number 2, which goes direct to Sejal Trehan. Sejal, Haddon Sundblom was an American artist who painted the color version of the Quaker Oats man. Quaker Oats, as you know, is a brand, and there is a person's picture on the logo or on the box of Quaker Oats. He is best known, the same guy, Haddon, is best known for popularizing the images of a mythical character when a beverage company hired him for a marketing campaign. Rumors soon spread that the festive character's outfit was made in red to match the company's colors. So, which very popular character is this? All of us are familiar with this character. And as a clue, we will get more familiar with this character next month. Okay? And which is this company that first used this character in their campaign? It's a beverage company.
So the character will be Santa Claus and the company will be Coca-Cola.
Perfect. Great answer, Sejal. Absolutely correct. It is indeed Santa Claus and the Coca-Cola company. This distinctive red color look of Santa Claus that we are all familiar with, a lot of people say that it came about because the Coca-Cola company used Santa Claus in their marketing campaigns, and the Coke color, of course, is always distinctively red. So, a good 10 points directly to Sejal. Well done, great answer. Suvansh, your question. Cheetahs are the fastest land animals. These members of the cat family have been known to reach speeds higher than 100 kilometers an hour. They have a feature which is different when compared to other members of the cat family. Modern shoe manufacturers, in fact, are using this feature to improve running shoes. What is this physical feature that helps cheetahs run very fast?
I'm going to take a guess on this one.
Sure.
But as far as I remember, cheetahs have retractable claws.
Okay.
And but it's not relevant. I think.
Go on.
Yeah. So cheetahs have retractable claws, mm-hmm. which help them to run fast when it needs to, and they can bring out their claws afterwards. So I think the answer should be retractable claws.
And how would that be kind of mirrored or copied by modern shoe manufacturers?
I think I know how it would be, but I can't visualize how it would be. I think it would be
what would you find on shoes that would help?
Oh, the treads which could come out or go inside when needed.
That's fine. I'll give it to you, though you're not exact with your answer, but I'll give it to you because you got the essential funda right. So cheetah claws are retractable, but they remain extended and act like spikes, right? Like those found in the shoes of sprinters. Mm-hmm. And this kind of gives them better grip and they are able to run much faster, right? Mm-hmm. So the extended claws of cheetahs, that's the claws part is essentially what I was looking for. And they are very similar to what you find spikes in modern running shoes. So that's 10 points to Suvansh. And the next question going direct to Arav. This English phrase suggests that any means possible must be taken to achieve a goal. One story behind its origin is that back in time, common people such as farmers and shepherds were allowed to collect waste wood to be used as firewood. They could collect as much wood as they could reach using either of two tools, and both these tools had rhyming names, right? The names of the two tools rhymed with each other. We'll show you the two tools on the next slide. There you go. There's one tool on the left and there is a kind of painting on the right showing another tool. Now seeing these, tell me what common English phrase comes from this. Go back to the text, please. And the meaning of the phrase is given in the first line, which says, any means possible must be taken to achieve a goal. A very common phrase. I'm sure y'all have come across this phrase. The answer is a few words, it's a phrase. Okay, Arav, please make a guess.
At all costs.
At all costs. Good guess, not at all costs. Devanshu?
Everything is fair in love and war.
Everything is fair in love and war. Good guess again. Not that. Passes on to number 3. Harish?
By hook or crook.
By hook or by crook. That's the right answer. By hook or crook. The cutting tool that you see there is called a bill hook. And the shepherds used a stick called a crook to manage their sheep. So you could collect firewood as much as you could while you were managing your sheep by using the bill hook. So the phrase by hook or crook. Very good, great answer there. 10 points to Harish. Question now goes to Harnoor. Harnoor, at the turn of the 20th century, British India consisted of 8 provinces that were administered either by a governor or a lieutenant governor. So these were the large provinces that are there. The table lists them. With an area of 170,000 square miles, which was the largest province that is missing from this list? So the next 7 that you see here are Bengal, Madras, Bombay, United Provinces, Central Provinces and Berar, Punjab and Assam. As a clue, remember that this was 1900s, early 1900s. So, and we are talking about British India. So not necessarily India as it is today. Okay, we are talking about British India. So, everything that used to be part of what the British used to call India at that time, we are not necessarily talking about India as it stands today. I am looking only for a one word answer. What was the largest province? You can see most important parts of India are covered in this list. So, there's Bengal and then there's Assam and there's Punjab and there's United Provinces, which was all around UP and that area. There's Central Province and Berar. There's Punjab, which of course is hometown for all of you. So, tell me what is missing.
I'm not sure, but I think it's Calcutta.
Calcutta, not Calcutta. Bengal is already covered over there, not Calcutta. Okay, let's move on. Going on next to Harshit.
It's the Patiala region, I guess, the Pepsu region.
Not Pepsu. Good guess, not Pepsu. Ratandeep?
So the Lahore region.
Lahore region. Okay, nice guess again. Not Lahore. Sejal?
The Northwestern Frontier Province.
NWFP. Okay, nice guess again. Those all came a little bit later. Not the Northwest Frontier Province. Suvansh?
Sir, I suppose it's Sindh, the Pakistan region of Sindh.
Sindh, okay, nice guess Sindh. Again, it's not Sindh. Let's move to Arav.
I'd like to say Bihar and those areas.
Bihar and those areas, okay. Not quite, passing you on to Devanshu.
Rajasthan.
Not Rajasthan. And final pass to Harish.
Myanmar.
I need the name as it was then.
Burma.
Burma is a very good answer. Excellent answer. It is Burma, right? So, Burma used to be a very important province. It was the largest province and part of British India at that time. Absolutely right. Great answer. 2 in a row from Harish. Burma is correct. The present day country of Myanmar. Well done, Harish. Another good 10 points to you. Question, therefore, again comes back to Harnoor. His first use of a rolled piece of paper is said to have been inspired by the flute which he used to play. He says, I happen to recollect a simple and well-known fact in acoustics. The great distinctness with which we hear the scratch of a pin at one end of a piece of wood on applying our ear to the other end. He wrote in the preface to a path-breaking paper in 1819. If you name the person, well and good, but you can simply tell us what is this listening invention that we are talking about. So this listening invention that this person came up with is a very, very important breakthrough invention, something that is very common in the world today. And he said that he was inspired by the flute. And there's a very good clue in the quote. He says, when we apply our ear to one end of the wood, we can hear the scratch of a pin at the other end. So simply tell me which invention. Something very, very common. All of you have seen this.
So, no idea.
Make some guess. Think about what invention would you use to, in this whole context of hearing and acoustics and things like that.
A sitar.
Passing you. Harshit?
Sir, can I get a minute, please?
No, not too much time on the pass, please. There's already been enough time when Harnoor was thinking. Please make a guess now.
No, I don't know.
Okay, Ratandeep?
It's the telephone.
Not the telephone. Sejal?
Stethoscope.
Sorry?
Stethoscope.
Stethoscope. And do you know who the person is?
No idea.
But we only asked you for the invention. Stethoscope is absolutely correct. This is René Lennox, the stethoscope, right? And he began the first prototype as just a rolled piece of paper and then went on to invent the stethoscope, which of course is a very, very integral and common accompaniment to any doctor's tools today. So good answer, Sejal. That gets you 10 more points on the stethoscope. Suvansh, the question comes to you. Okay, in this one you are going to hear an audio clip. This is a famous composer called Gustav Holst. He made a musical piece called The Planets, and each piece was on one planet in the solar system. Now when you listen to this piece that we are going to play you, you will get the feeling that the rhythms and the drum beats give the music a kind of military feel. So which planet is this piece based on? Part 1, so just give me the name of planet. And part 2, why does the military theme fit well with the planet's name? So, which planet was this piece based on? It's from his musical suite called The Planets. And why is this kind of a music? Why was it chosen for this planet? Question for Suvansh Mahajan.
I think I know this. The planet would be Mars.
Okay.
Because Mars is basically the Roman god of war.
And his other
name is Ares.
And he is the god of war, which is why the whole military beat feel would
get
into the theme. Absolutely correct, Suvansh. That's the perfect answer. This is Mars. So he has a complete suite starting from Mercury all the way to Pluto. And this is Mars. And Mars is the Roman god of war, which is why a very military themed kind of beat you could hear over there. So good 10 points to Suvansh on that. And Arav gets the next question. In this 2017 book, historian Patrice Guinefi compares two exemplars of political and military leadership. This is a dual biography of two leaders who both became national figures in the same country at the times of crisis and war. One of them in the 19th century and one of them in the 20th century. Who are the two leaders in question? Remember, both are from the same country and this is a kind of double biography. So it traces the stories and the lives of two important leaders. Both these leaders stood up for their country and led their country in times of crisis and war, one in the 19th century and one in the 20th century. And you can see the kind of headgear they used to wear is on the cover. That might give you a little bit of help. Look also at the historian's name and see if that gives you a clue as to which country this could be. I'll give you an additional clue. The second leader, the second name on this, that person's name is given to the airport of the capital city of this country. So just like India's capital city, New Delhi, has the Indira Gandhi International Airport, this country's capital city's main airport is named after the second leader. And the first leader is a leader that all of you know very well. Okay, another 10 seconds before Arav makes a guess. Okay, Arav, can we have an answer?
I don't have any clue, but I'll say John F. Kennedy.
John F. Kennedy. Okay, John F. Kennedy is already done. Devanshu?
I also don't know much, but I think the first should be Napoleon.
Okay, and the second?
I don't know.
You don't know? Okay, Harish?
I think it's George Washington and Abraham Lincoln.
Abraham Lincoln and?
George Washington.
George Bush, okay.
George Washington.
George Washington, okay. Abraham Lincoln and George Washington, not quite. Timelines don't fit. Okay, let's move on to Harnoor.
I think it's King Luther Jr. and Napoleon.
Napoleon and who are you saying for the second one?
King Luther Jr.
No, passing you to Harshit.
So I think the second one is Vladimir Lenin of Russia.
Okay. And the first one?
Napoleon.
Napoleon. I said from the same country, not Napoleon and Lenin. Ratandeep?
So the first one is Napoleon Bonaparte, though I'm not sure on the second, I'll guess Emmanuel Macron.
Emmanuel Macron. Okay, not Emmanuel Macron. Sejal?
The first one is Napoleon and the second one is De Gaulle.
De Gaulle, that's the right answer. Absolutely right. Charles De Gaulle. Yeah. Napoleon Bonaparte and Charles de Gaulle, two generals, two leaders who led their countries, and a very interesting dual biography of both of them. So Devanshu gets 5 points for saying Napoleon, and Sejal gets the full 10 points for saying Napoleon and de Gaulle. And of course, the main airport at Paris is called the Charles de Gaulle Airport. Yeah. Okay, question number 9 of the clockwise round goes to Suvansh. This sport has featured in every edition of the modern Summer Olympics starting from 1896. It has 3 events, one of which is called foil. In each event, the main equipment used is a little bit different. The third event is also the name of a curved sword associated with the cavalry. And you can find the name of this event also in the name of a prehistoric extinct animal. It is in the part of the name of the prehistoric extinct animal. So, which is this Olympic event which has 3 sub-events and what is the third event called?
Okay, so I know the Olympic sport, it's fencing.
Alright.
And the third event would be saber.
Saber, and what would be the prehistoric animal?
The saber-toothed tiger.
Perfect answer, absolutely right. This is fencing, and you have foil, epi and saber, the 3 techniques or sub-events in fencing. And saber, of course, is the name of an actual sword that is used by the cavalry. And you also find its name in the saber-toothed tiger. Excellent answer. Full 10 points to Suvansh once again. And question coming back again to Arav. Arav. 3 movies by this director have been India's official entries for the Best Foreign Language Film Award at the Oscars. 2 of them are Shatranj Ke Khiladi and Mahanagar. The first movie was a 1959 Bengali film based on a story written by the Bengali author Bibhuti Bhushan Bandyopadhyay. Who is this famous director and which was the first film of his that was India's entry to the Oscars? And there is a good reason why we are asking about this film as well. Who is this famous director and which was the first film of his that was India's entry to the Oscars? He is the only director to have had three of his films become India's official entries at the Oscars. All right, Arav, go for it.
Again, no clue, but I'll go with Satyajit Ray.
Satyajit Ray. And do you have a guess on the film?
No, I do not.
Okay, we'll pass you on to Devanshu.
I also thought about Satyajit Ray, but I don't know the film.
Okay, we'll pass you on to Harish.
I'll go with Satyajit Ray, but no idea of the film.
Okay, we will pass you on to Harnoor.
I don't have any idea about this.
Okay, we will pass you on to Harshit.
So Satyajit Ray and Satyavadi Harishchandra.
Not Satyavadi Harishchandra. Passing you on to Ratandeep.
Sir, I know the director is Satyajit Ray, but I don't know the film.
You don't know the film? Okay, passing you on to Sejal.
Sir, the director is Sumitra Chatterjee, passed away recently, but I don't know the film.
Okay. Last pass to Suvansh.
I'm gonna say it would be Satyajit Ray, and the first movie was Bengali film based on a story written by Bengali author. Satyajit Ray. I think it was Appu.
I need a specific name for the film.
For the film?
Yeah.
It's Satyajit Ray and Appu. So I know it's Appu something, but Appu. Dr. Appu.
Okay. Not Dr. Appu. You are very close. So, Arav gets 5 points. Of course, Satyajit Ray, the great Satyajit Ray, is correct. The answer is Appur Sansar or Appu's World. It's part of the Appu trilogy, which begins with the famous film Pother Panchali, and then Aparajito, and then Appur Sansar. And the reason we put up this question is, as Sejal said, Soumitra Chatterjee, who passed away recently, made his acting debut with Appur Sansar. Right? So, one of the great actors of all time of Indian cinema, unfortunately passed away recently. This is our tribute question to him. Satyajit Ray and Appur Sansar, it's correct. So, we will give 5 points to Arav and the question now passes. The next question goes to Devanshu. Devanshu, in Greek mythology, the naiads are female spirits that preside over fountains and springs. Triton is a son of Poseidon. Thalassa is the spirit of the sea. Despina is a daughter of Poseidon. Now, Naiads, Triton, Thalassa and Despina, along with a few more characters, are part of a sect. It is interesting to note that all of them have a connection with water. What is this celestial sect and why were these picked due to their connection with water? So, remember, it's a celestial sect.
Yeah. First, if we talk in Greek mythology, then yeah, the god of the seas was Poseidon.
Okay.
While it was in Roman mythology, it was Neptune. Naiads, the dry spirits of the trees.
Okay. So what is your answer? What is this set? Naiads, Triton, Thalassa, Despina. What are all of them today in a celestial context?
I can't guess, but I read it in a book.
No, you are kind of on the right track. So, Just tell me a specific answer. What are all of them?
So they were all... I cannot say, because half of them were gods and half of them were humans. The first son of Poseidon, that was Perseus.
Okay.
And the naiads were on... So I really do not guess. I know about all of their environment and things because I read it in the book of Percy Jackson, all okay. 10 series.
Okay, okay. Okay, let's pass you on and see what the others have to say. Harish?
Are these sea nymphs or sea spirits?
Sea nymphs, and okay.
Sea nymphs or sea spirits, and these are picked in the connection of water because their habitat is water.
Their habitat and is water. Most, okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Passing you on to Harnoor.
So the celestial set, maybe it's a god of waters, and because all of these are water bodies, so they can name like
okay. God of water and all of them being water bodies. Okay, passing you on to Harshit.
Yeah, so god of water and there might be some fish.
Okay, some kind of fish. Alright. Passing you on to Ratandeep.
I believe the celestial set could be that they're all names of stars because Triton is the name. Names of moons.
Names of moons. Triton moons of what?
Is the name of a moon. Moons and I don't know why the connection with water.
No, but Ratandeep, these are all, when you say names of moons, moons of what?
One minute. Triton. I believe. Could I get a moment, sir?
Yeah. You said they're all moons. So, all moons, as you know, would be associated with, planets. So, these are all then, therefore, moons of what?
I believe Saturn.
Saturn. Okay. And why were they picked with their connection to water?
Because Saturn's rings are made of ice.
Saturn's rings are made of ice. Okay. Nice guess. Nice guess. Sejal?
These are all moons of Neptune and they were picked because Neptune is blue.
Because Neptune is blue.
Okay. Yes, we do represent it as being blue.
As being
so, blue. All of these are water spirits, water essentially. Spots.
Okay.
And they were, are the names of the moons of Neptune.
Neptune. Okay. Suvansh?
It's the moons of Neptune because Neptune is the Roman god of water, or Poseidon, who is the god of water in Greek mythology.
That's as simple as that. That's all we wanted. Right? Neptune's moons, and it was simply picked because Neptune himself is the god of water, right? Neptune is the equivalent, Roman equivalent of Poseidon, and Neptune himself is the god of water. So they thought that for the moons of Neptune, they should pick all of these mythological characters which have a water connection. So Ratandeep started on the right track, but unfortunately went with Saturn. Tough luck. Sejal gets 5 points for saying Neptune's moons. But 10 points stolen away on this one by Suvansh for completing that answer. Several others came close, and actually Devanshu started perfectly by mentioning Neptune somewhere in the answer, but you didn't kind of mention that in your final guess. So I couldn't take that, unfortunately. Okay, Arav, penultimate question of the clockwise round coming to you. The last question, in fact, of the clockwise round. Okay, three creatures. What is the commonality shared by them with respect to their names? You don't have to give me all their names, but tell me what commonality is shared among their names. We'll show you bigger pictures. So, this is the first one. This is the second one. And this is the third one. So, certain commonality is shared by all of them with regard to their names. And it's a kind of, I would say, slightly funny type commonality. Slightly unusual kind of common thing that all of them share. Arav's question, last one of the clockwise round. After the clockwise round is over, we'll take a minute's break. for me to have some water, and we'll also check on the scores. Okay, Arav, time to start guessing. What do you think is common to all their names, which is a little unusual?
They're warm-blooded.
No, I'm not, like I said, you need to tell me what is common to their names, not what is common to the creatures. What is common to the names of these creatures?
They're named after something.
Okay. They are not named after something, but good guess. We want an answer like that. Devanshu?
I don't even know the names. I can't guess.
Okay. Harish?
Is the commonality between them the word sheep?
The word sheep. No, not the word sheep. Harnoor?
So maybe hoppers is the commonality between the names.
What is the commonality?
Hoppers.
Okay, not quite. Harshit?
So snow?
Snow. Nothing to do with snow. Ratandeep?
Seeing that they sort of have bumps on their backs, I'll say humped.
Humped. Okay, nice guess. Not humped. Sejal?
So I think one's a dragonfly and a yeti. I think they're all like mythical creatures.
Mythical.
Like the names are derived from... mythical. Which are considered mythical.
Mythical. Good guess.
These are obviously real.
Good guess. Good guess. Not quite. Okay, Suvansh.
I can only guess on this one, but I'm going to say they're named after fictional characters from books or...
Fictional characters from books.
Harry Potter. Or something.
Not that. This is not that question. There are several creatures who have now been named after Harry Potter names and so on. This is a very interesting answer. Nobody gets this one. The first one of the quiz that comes back to the quiz master. I'm sure the people watching in the view room, some of you might know. Let's see the answer. These are all misleading names, right? So the first one is the electric eel, which is not an eel at all. It's a type of fish. The second one's called a mountain goat, but it's not a goat. It's actually an antelope. And the third one is called the mayfly because of the belief that it was kind of seen only or lived only in May. But it's actually seen throughout the summer and not just in May, right? So these are misleading names of these creatures. So an interesting and tough one to end the clockwise round. Time to now take a look at the scores. We have Harnoor and Harshit yet to open their accounts. Arav on 5, Devanshu and Ratandeep on 10, Harish on 20 in third place, and a close fight going on at the top with Sejal on 35. And Suvansh on 40. It could have very well been Sejal on 40 and Suvansh on 30. The Neptune question kind of shifted that balance a little bit. But it's a very close contest. Good to see. Welcome to round 2 of Pantomathics, the inter-school quiz contest presented to you by St. Kabir Public School and Nexus Consulting. After that exciting round 1, round 2 is an interesting new format called Chaturang. You have to pick a question from the grid. The unanswered questions here will not pass. If you are sure of the answer after seeing the question, you can go for a power play for plus 15. But if you say power play and get your answer wrong, you'll get a minus 5, right? So if you don't say anything, we will assume that you are playing regular, plus 10, 0. If you do want to say power play, you'll have to, if you want to play a power play, you'll have to say power play very clearly, okay? And this is not a random grid. Let's see how this grid is. This grid spells out Pantomathics, okay? And you can pick a letter and your answer will begin with that letter, okay? So you have P-A-N-T-O-M-A-T-H-I-C-S. So you have enough options to pick from. Okay, so this is your pick your gambit round. As I told you, you pick an option. You pick a letter from the word Pantomathics. So, if you are picking an A or a T, please mention whether it's A1, A2 or T1, T2. You have 12 options to pick from and there are 8 of you, so enough options. Once you pick it, see the question. If you think you are very sure, say power play and then give your answer. Otherwise, just give your answer directly. Let's start with Arav.
I'll go with T1.
You'll go with T1. Okay, T1 for Arav. There is uncertainty over exactly how this historical figure was injured. It probably happened in AD 1363 in a desert battle in southwest Afghanistan. A Soviet archaeological team opened his tomb in 1941 to verify if the reports of the injury were true. They found that it was correct. He was a well-built man of about 5 feet 7 inch, but his right leg was shorter than the left leg. And that's how he got his nickname. Which historical figure are we talking about? And please give your answer along with the nickname. And if you're sure of it, please mention power play.
How much time do I have?
You have the next 10 seconds to give me an answer.
Babur.
Not Babur. I'm sorry about that. It's not Babur. We'll invite one of the other contestants to unmute themselves and give an answer.
Can I?
Yes, Suvan.
Can I?
Timur the Lame.
Timur the Lame is correct. Tamerlane or Timur the Lame, and they did find out that he was indeed lame, which is why he had an injury to one of his legs, which is why he was called Timur the Lame. Okay, tough luck, Arav didn't get that. Devanshu's turn to pick now.
I'll take S.
You'll take S, alright, the last one of the lot, S. The man in the picture is Felix Dadayev. His training began around 1940 when he was in his 20s. He watched countless newsreels of somebody. The chief of the secret police in his country personally trained him. He was also taught how to apply a makeup. His final test was at the Kremlin. If he could convince those people, then he could officially assume a particular role. So see the picture as well and tell me what was Dadayev being trained for. Okay, this is the picture of Felix Dadayev. Go back to the text, please. Yeah. So, what was he being trained for? He watched lots of newsreels of somebody. The chief of the secret police of this country personally trained him. And he was also taught how to apply a makeup. Remember your answer somewhere. The key word in your answer needs to begin with the letter S.
Wait a second. Let me think.
Look at the name.
Spying.
Sorry?
Sir, he was taught to be a spy in, like, be an undercover person or spy in different ways by applying makeup.
He was taught to be, he was being taught to be a spy. Okay, no, not quite, not what we were looking for. Does anybody else want to try?
Yes.
Yeah, Harish, yes. Let Harish try.
Actually, he was being trained to be a body double of Stalin.
That is the right answer. He was being trained to be the body double for Stalin, right? So, he had watched all of these newsreels of Stalin, and if he could convince the officials in the Kremlin that he was indeed Stalin, then he could get the job, which he did get. So, he was the body double of Stalin. Okay, that goes unanswered as well, and we now go to Harish himself to pick the next one.
I'll pick H.
We'll pick H, okay. He perfected the process of drying milk and his product became a big hit thanks to its convenience. When ice cream parlors became popular, it helped his business grow because his product was sold in them. Travelers carried it everywhere. He was one of the principal backers of Roald Amundsen's expedition to find the South Pole. Thanks to his contributions, surveyors even named a mountain in Antarctica after him. Who is this famous person? His surname is the name of a very famous brand of packaged foods associated with milk, okay? It is a packaged food, so it is a kind of powder. I will tell you that, typically. But it can be available in various forms and it's a brand we are well familiar with in India as well.
Is it Milo?
You picked H. So, your answer needs to start with H. It is not Milo. I'm sorry. Anybody else wants to try? Nobody?
Hershey's?
No, not Hershey's. No. Travelers used to carry it everywhere because it was very easy and convenient to consume. Let's see the answer. The answer is Horlicks. The answer is Horlicks. This is William Horlick, and a very important mountain range in Antarctica is called the Horlick Mountain after William Horlick of the brand Horlicks. Okay. All right, this round seems to be a bit of a toughie. Nobody has scored so far. Let's see how Harnoor goes. Harnoor, what do you want to pick?
So P.
P. Okay, Harnoor has picked P. These books revolutionized the publishing industry. The name of the imprint was evocative of the utility value of the books. They could easily be carried around. And that is your important clue. These books got their name because they could be easily carried around. They were priced at 25 cents. The logo was an animal, Gertrude the kangaroo, named after the artist's mother-in-law. What is this brand of books that was established in 1939? So your answer needs to be dash books. And the dash is the answer that begins with the letter P. And your key clue is that it could be easily carried around. So it was easy to carry around, and it was so small and easy to carry around that it could fit very easily in your dress. So using that as a clue, tell me what is this brand of books called?
Are they pocket books?
Pocket books is a good answer. Finally, somebody scores. Good answer there. Pocket books. The books were small enough to fit into coat pockets and therefore became very, very popular with commuters, people who would travel and so on, because they could easily put these books in one of their coat or jacket pockets and read on their journey. Very good, Harnoor. You get 10 points on that. Good one there. Now, since we have finished four questions, we will do the next four anti-clockwise, just like we did in the semi-finals. So, Suvansh, it's now your turn to pick.
I'll go with M.
You'll go with the M, alright. Some people claim that this preparation was invented in the 1700s when a storm damaged a ship carrying a cargo of oranges. An enterprising man took the whole ship load, turned the contents into a delicious eatable and made a fortune. Another story says Mary Queen of Scots ate some when she had a headache. Her maids would wander around whispering, "Marie is ill" in French, and that is how the preparation is said to have got its name. What is this typically delicious preparation?
I'm gonna go with it's marmalade.
You didn't say parplay, so you get only 10 points. Marmalade is absolutely correct. Well done. Marmalade. And you know, the if you break down the word marmalade, and it would kind of mean that someone is ill, malady, that type of thing. So Mary is ill, marmalade. And that's how one disputed origin of it is. And the other more interesting about the ship sinking and somebody taking the entire load and making orange marmalade out of it. Well done, good answer. 10 points, Suvansh. So, Suvansh has moved into a lead, and now it's chance for Sejal to catch up. So, Sejal, what letter would you like to pick?
N.
N, alright, N for Sejal. It may seem that this business is a new one, but it's just that it's become more popular in recent years. It was founded in 1997 by two colleagues from a software company. Their main competitor at that time was a company called Blockbuster. The future did not turn out well for Blockbuster. It could not compete with this new brand and it became bankrupt in 2010. Which company outshone Blockbuster? Your answer begins with the letter N, and it's a very, very popular and common company today. And I'm sure...
Yes, sir. Powerplay.
Okay, Powerplay.
Netflix,
absolutely correct. Well done, well played on the power play. Netflix, which is a streaming service today, originally began as a DVD rental service, a chain of DVD rental shops. The biggest brand in that space used to be Blockbuster in the US. And after Netflix coming in, it kind of shut down. And then, of course, Netflix has pioneered the streaming service across the world today with some great shows, films, and so on. Excellent, 15 points to Sejal. I think that ties up the scores right now. Wonderful. All right, let's go to Ratandeep.
I'll take C.
You'll take C. All right. Diamonds are given various names after the colors they exhibit. Water is used for the most colorless variety. Some diamonds were also named after locations. pale yellow-colored varieties from South Africa were known as dash diamonds. The Portuguese were the first Europeans to discover this area and the sea route to India by going around it. So, what was the short name given to this variety of diamond after this particular location or feature in South Africa? And the Portuguese were the first to discover this. And a good clue for you is that they discovered this while discovering the sea route to India by going around this. So, give me an answer that begins with C. Think about a famous geographical feature that is there in South Africa. Which would typically be along a sea route.
So, Cairo.
Cairo, not Cairo. Unfortunately, not Cairo. All right. We're going to see who wants to attempt it. Sejal, do you want to try? Yes, Sejal.
Cape of Good Hope.
Yes, these were called Cape Diamonds after the Cape of Good Hope, right? The southernmost point of Africa, and that was an important I would say inflection point in the sea route to India, the Cape of Good Hope. So, these are called Cape Diamonds, all right? Okay, last question of this round goes to Harshit. Harshit, would you like A1, O, A2, T2?
Sir, I will go with O.
You will go with O. Alright. See. The Oxford English Dictionary says that the word oology first appeared in print in English in 1830. It was in an advertisement for the soon-to-be-published book, British Oology. The book makes some interesting observations about the objects that are studied in oology. One observation is that birds such as owls and kingfishers hide these objects in holes. So, first you have to figure out what is it that an oologist studies. And if you figure that out, tell me what is the largest object that is studied by an oologist. And your answer, remember, needs to begin with the letter O. So, what is oology the study of? And if you figure that out, what is the largest object noted or studied by oologists?
Ostrich eggs.
Ostrich eggs is a good answer. Excellent. Oologists study eggs, and the biggest egg in the world is the ostrich egg.
Yes.
Right? Ostrich eggs. Well worked out. Great answer, Harshit. 10 points to you. And that brings us to the end of our Chaturang round. We will take a quick look at the score. Alright. So, we have Arav on 5 still. We have Devanshu, Ratandeep and Harshit and Harnoor all on 10. We have Harish still in third place on 20, but in a tie for first place at the moment are Sejal Trehan and Suvansh Mahajan, both at 50 points. Right, 12 questions to go anti-clockwise. We're going to go a little fast now because we've lost time about 15 minutes with the technical glitch. So, we want to make that up and finish this off by about 1 o'clock. So, we're going to go a little fast. So, round 3, same rules as before, we go anti-clockwise, we start with Suvansh and infinite bounds, plus 10, no negatives, part points where applicable, and hands in front of camera please at all points of time. Harshit and yeah, can I all request all of you to please keep your hands in front of camera. Right, okay, anti-clockwise, question number 1 goes to Suvansh. This instrument is named after a country, so it has a 2-word name, the first word references a country. Some people say that it's one of the hardest instruments to master. Left-handers might like it because unlike all other instruments, the keys have to be played with the left hand. What is the instrument called? 2-word name. What do you do with your right hand while playing it? So, that's where you are supposed to, that's where you're supposed to blow into while playing the instrument. You can see a bunch of complicated keys in between. Those keys are typically supposed to be played with your left hand. So, logically tell me what will you do with your right hand while playing this instrument, right? And what is it called? It's the answer has a country name in it in some way.
So, what I can say is when you like play the keys with the left hand, with the right hand, you have to pull that I don't know what it's called, but you have
what
to.
You're saying. Okay,
yes, you have to pull that and to blow in. Right. And this instrument is called the Scottish trombone.
The Scottish trombone. Okay, passing you on that to Sejal.
So this is the Scottish trombone, and while we are playing the keys with the left hand, with the right hand we hold it,
okay,
because it is quite heavy. Okay. So we hold it like.
You hold it with your right hand. Okay, passing you on to Ratandeep.
So the instrument is the French horn, and you hold it with the right hand.
You hold it with your right hand. I need a better answer for the second part.
So the end of the where the sound comes out, you hold that part with your right hand, and the instrument is called a French horn.
So you put your right hand in the part where the sound comes out. That's what you're saying.
Yeah, near that.
Near that. Okay, I think that is good enough for points. We'll give it to you. It is the French horn. You essentially, you know, you hold it in the sense of you continue to hold it with your left hand, but you put your hand literally inside the horn, right? So you put it at the part where the sound comes out because it helps control the sound waves. I think that's close enough to the answer for me to give you points at my discretion. So 10 points there to Ratandeep for a very good answer. Well done. If there was an audience here, you would have heard a loud applause for that good answer from yourself, Ratandeep. Okay, so just imagine it in your head right now that many people in an auditorium are applauding you for that answer. And we will move on to Harshit and give him the next question. Okay, Harshit, here's a chemistry question for you. The elements Cm, BH, Es, Rg, Fm, Lr, Rf and Sg and the elements Mt, Cn, Og, Md and No are all named in a similar way. So they have some commonality. So the group where the first set of elements, so Cm all the way to Sg, that particular group, whatever it is named after, they have something unique or they have something special. So where do these elements get their names from, and what is unique about the first set? Even if you are able to identify a few of the elements, the first part should be.
Sir, the name of the presidents and the famous personalities. RF is Rutherfordium, so.
Okay.
He was a scientist.
Okay, so the first part of your answer is that they are these are all elements named after famous personalities.
Yes.
And the second part you are saying, you need to tell me what is unique about the set which has Cm, BH, Es, Rg, Fm, Lr, Rf, and Sg.
They are all. Famous scientists.
Can you give me something a bit more specific?
Cm is, I guess, curium. Okay. Rg is Rf is Rutherfordium.
Okay.
Francium, Fm. Of the countries or the famous personalities, these are named after.
No. Make up your mind and tell me. You said they're all named after scientists. Give me something a bit more specific, like something.
Who made certain discoveries?
Something
scientists who made certain discoveries regarding these elements.
Something even more specific in terms of who discovered these elements themselves. Okay, I'll pass you on that to Harnoor.
Yes, sir. So I think they are based of scientists who worked in the fields of chemistry and found these elements.
They founded these elements, you're saying?
Yeah, it is based on the names of scientists. Okay. Who are excelled in the fields of chemistry.
What do you mean when you say excelled in the fields of chemistry?
They are the founders of certain elements in the periodic table.
They are founders of certain elements in the periodic table. Okay, alright, we'll have to pass you on that to Harish.
Sir, these elements derived their names from Latin language and the other scientists and who worked in their field and got Nobel Prizes for them.
Who worked in the field and got Nobel Prizes for them. So, your two answers are, they get the name, so all of them, what is common to all of them?
They get their name from Latin. They get their names from Latin.
They get their names from Latin, okay. And for the second part, you are saying?
The first set is actually in group 1, sir. So, basically, these are intertransitional elements.
No, not what I was looking for. Sorry about that. Passing you to Devanshu.
No, I don't think I have any idea. But yeah, they were connected with certain scientists.
Okay.
I discovered them.
scientists who discovered them. Okay, Arav?
They are named after scientists who helped in the discovery of the atom.
Okay. Helped in and the discovery of the atom. And for the, what are you saying for the first set? What is unique about the first set?
They are heavy atoms with which are radioactive in nature.
Not what I was looking for. Comes back to Suvansh.
I suppose all these elements are named after scientists.
Okay.
And the what is unique about the first set is that all of them are named after physicists and chemists.
Chemists specifically. No, not good enough for the answer. Sejal?
Okay, so all these elements are named after scientists who have been awarded the Nobel Prize in chemistry, such as curium, Marie Curie. And the unique thing about this set is that all these elements are radioactive.
Okay, I think we'll close it because we heard the answer from you. Let's see the answer. They're all named after people, and the first set is named after people who won the Nobel Prize, right? So you had curium, borium, einsteinium, and so on. And Rutherfordium, those are all people who won the Nobel Prize. The second set had, you know, generally other people. So, you had Mendelevium, Copernicium and Nobelium and so on in the second set. While you had Curium, Borium, Fermium and so on in the first set. So, I wanted elements named after scientists or people. Not all of them were technically scientists, but that's good enough. But I wanted the Nobel laureates part for the second part. I think Harish kind of started over there and then you changed your answer a little bit. Sorry about that. Who said elements named after scientists or people first?
Harshit, sir.
Harshit said that. Okay. So, Harshit gets 5 points and Sejal gets the full 10 points. Right? Next question to Ratandeep. In 1967, Catherine Switzer signed up as K. Switzer in an event that did not allow women to participate. A few miles into the event, she was attacked by an official who yelled at her to get out. The other men near her pushed the official away and she went on to become the first woman to officially complete the event. What is this annual event? It's a pretty famous event that happens in a city in the US, which is now more than 120 years old. How was she officially able to sign up? Let's see the picture. It's quite a dramatic picture. So, you can see in the picture on the left, some official coming and trying to pull her out because women were not allowed in this event. And then you can see that the other people who were there in the event pushed out the official. So, wearing that bib 261, this lady became the first one to complete this event. So, the event is now more than 120 years old. You can see what type of event it is, obviously. And it is held in a prominent US city. So, what is the event and in how was it when women were not allowed that she was able to sign up? Like, how did the officials accept her entry? That's literally given in the question. You just need to kind of, mention that in your answer. That's about it.
So, she was able to sign up because she disguised her name as the name of a male. Okay. And so, could I get a moment for the event?
Yeah, sure. So, 120-year-old event. It happens annually in a prominent city in the US.
Sir, the Boston Marathon?
Is a good answer. Very good. Well done. It is the Boston Marathon. So, she just gave her surname, K. Switzer. And the officials registered Switzer and assumed it was a male name. And this is indeed the Boston Marathon, where a few years ago a terrible bombing happened as well. This is indeed the Boston Marathon and Catherine Switzer became the first woman to compete at the Boston Marathon. Excellent answer, Ratandeep. 10 points to you. Well done. Question now goes to Harshit. Harshit, simple one for you, I think. A king of Phrygia, a region nowadays part of Turkey, was at his court one day when some of the farmhands brought him a satyr they had caught. The king immediately recognized the satyr as Silenus, a friend of the god Dionysus, and set him free. The satyr was grateful to the king for treating him with dignity, and so was Dionysus. The god was so pleased, in fact, that he offered to grant whatever the king wanted to wish for. What did the king wish for? Who was the king and what did he wish for? He was a king of Phrygia. Very, very famous. Something that you have definitely heard of. Harshit, quickly give us an answer.
Sir, I have not heard of this.
Okay.
But I guess it at eternity.
Eternity. No, nothing to do with eternity. Harnur?
Immortality. Eternity.
Not immortality. Harnur? Who was this king and what did he wish for?
I think he wished for respect in his country.
He wished for what?
Respect.
Respect in his country. No. Harish?
He wished for the well-being of his people.
No. You are all taking very general guesses. Why would it be an interesting question in that case? Devanshu?
So, I know that a setter is a person that is half goat and half human. Dionysus was the god of wine.
Okay.
And yeah, I think that he was granted the he was King Midas.
Okay.
And was granted the wish of the touch of gold.
Perfect answer. That's all we were looking for. This is the story of King Midas, who got the wish that, or the boon that everything he touched would be turned into gold. Right. So this was King Midas, the king of Phrygia at that time. Nicely done and well explained on what is a satyr and what is Dionysus by Devanshu. Devanshu gets 10 points. Question now goes to Arav. Arav, we're going to play you a video clip. This is the 1967 appearance as an old steward on a ship of an actor. This was his last on-screen appearance. His first on-screen appearance came in 1914 as an out-of-work swindler. Who is the actor? All that we are asking you is, who is the actor? Watch the clip.
Who is it?
Chief Joker.
Excuse me, do you mind closing all your portholes, sir?
Yes, it seems to be blowing up out there.
Oh, just a little sloppy, nothing serious.
Yeah. So simply tell us who that is. This was his last on-screen appearance in 1967, and you can see that he has worked for a long time because his first appearance was as an out-of-work swindler in 1914. Somebody again very, very famous, an actor whom all of us has heard of, has seen and has enjoyed.
No clue. I'd say Robert De Niro.
Robert De Niro, not Robert De Niro. Suvanch?
I'm going to guess Charlie Chaplin.
And you're going to guess right. That's the correct answer. Well done. This is indeed Charlie Chaplin's career. Charlie Chaplin, the tramp, the very, very famous comedian. His last on-screen appearance was as a steward on a ship. Well worked out, well guessed. I think from the timeline and from the long career that he had and a little bit of the facial resemblance, you could work out that answer. Charlie Chaplin, good answer. 10 points to Suvanch. Question comes to Sejal. Keen contest going on between the two of them. The Flag Act of this country states that the flag colors are sky blue, dash red, and snow white. The colors symbolize the three elements that make up the land: blue for mountains, white for ice, and red for the dash found in this country. All the countries in this region have a cross on their flags. We'll show you the flag itself. Simply tell us which country. And what does the red color in the flag stand for? So this is the flag. So there's a blue, a white, and a red. The blue is supposed to stand for the sky and for the sea. The white is supposed to stand for the snow. What does the red stand for? And all the countries in the, you could see that it was a red cross on this flag. All the countries in this region have a similar kind of cross.
The country is Iceland, and the red, like, can I get the second for it? Sky blue, snow white, dash red, blood red.
What does it stand for? It says
the
red for the dash found in this country. So you said blood red. It's not blood red. It doesn't stand for blood. So we'll pass you on to Ratandeep.
So the country is definitely Iceland, and maybe fire for red.
Fire. Okay. Nope. We need something more specific. Passes to Harshit.
Sir, crimson red.
Not crimson red. Again, not looking for an answer like that. Don't describe the red. Not crimson red. Passes to Harnoor.
Yes, the country is Iceland, but the red maybe symbolizes iron found in the country.
Iron found in the country. Okay, that's a nice guess. Not iron found in the country. Passes to Harish.
So the country is Iceland, and maybe the red color symbolizes Denmark, because it is under Denmark.
Okay. The red color symbolizes Denmark. Okay. No, Iceland is not under Denmark in that sense. Devanshu?
Yeah, so the country is Iceland, but I think there's a red river in Iceland.
Okay, there's a red river in Iceland. Okay, interesting guess. Passes to Arav.
That one.
I'd say that the country is Iceland, but the red color is due to volcanic activity.
Perfect answer, Arav. Excellent answer. Absolutely correct. Iceland has a huge number of volcanoes. You know, you would have heard of the volcano eruption in Iceland some years ago, which threw ash and covered the entire airspace of Europe and so on. So, the red color is supposed to symbolize the volcanoes and the volcanic activity in Iceland. Excellent answer. 10 points to Arav on that, and 5 points to Sejal, who said Iceland. So 5 to Sejal and 10 to Arav. Question comes all the way back to Suvansh. Okay. We're going to play you an audio clip. The best known version, which was accompanied with an updated logo, was written by Jerry Goldsmith and first heard in the 1997 movie The Lost World Jurassic Park. This is one such version, taken from the soundtrack of a 2015 movie. What is this the theme of, and what was the 2015 film, specifically looking for the name of the 2015 film? Be a little careful with the first part, because you might have two alternate answers. Think through it. Give me a guess for the first part. I think the film should be easy.
Yeah, the film is Minions, the Despicable Me, Minions, Despicable Me. And the theme is Universal Studios.
Are you sure it's not 20th Century Fox and Universal Studios?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's Universal Studios.
Let's see the answer. It is Universal Studios. Well done. Universal Studios and Minions. You know, a lot of people potentially get confused between the famous 20th Century Fox fanfare as well. But this was Universal Studios. Well worked out and well answered, Suvansh. Universal Studios and Minions is absolutely right. That gets you 10 points. Sejal, chance for you once again to play catch up. Here we go. We are talking about the smells that are let out from an object that is used for a few days towards the end of the year. One of the chemicals it is made up of is boronyl acetate. This is something that is also used in products like car and bathroom deodorizers. Other chemicals that contribute are alpha-pinene, beta-pinene, limonene and myrcene. They have a turpentine-like odor found in volatile oils. Some of these polymers are flammable, which is why these things also burn well. We are talking about the aroma of blank blank. Fill in the blanks. Read the first line very carefully. The first sentence very carefully. That should give you a very big clue.
Is it like a fireplace or a tinderwood.
Tinderwood, okay. Tinderwood in a fireplace. Good guess. Not tinderwood in a fireplace. We'll pass you on to Ratandeep.
Incense stick.
Incense sticks, not incense sticks. Passing you on to Harshit.
Sir, I can't make any guess.
Okay. Passing you on to Harnoor.
I don't have any idea about this.
Okay, we'll pass you on to Harish.
Sorry, are these aerosol sprays?
Aerosol sprays, not aerosol sprays. Devanshu?
So, the flower jasmine?
The jasmine flower, interesting guess. No, Arav?
Eucalyptus oil.
Not eucalyptus oil and comes back all the way to Suvansh.
Sir, naphthalene balls or mothballs?
Good guess, but not mothballs. Your key clue was that it's an object that is used for a few days towards the end of the year. We already had one related question to this theme. We are talking about the aroma of Christmas trees. We're talking about the aroma of Christmas trees. Yeah, these artificial Christmas trees that you find. It's lit up for a few days towards the end of the year. And then typically it is burnt, and it burns very well because, as you might know, these are obviously not natural trees. In most cases, these are artificial Christmas trees. Okay, so one question in this set as well comes to the quizmaster, which is fair enough. I think you all have answered everything else. So that's good. Four more questions to go. Let's hope all those get answered. Ratandeep, this is your question. On 14 January 1898, John Darling, later to be captain of Australia, entered the record books for a piece of trivia. He had just whacked the ball out of the Adelaide Oval. This first had taken 54 tests to happen. By the end of the test, which Australia won by an innings, he had done it twice more. So, what did he enter the record books for? And why did it actually take 54 tests for this to happen? In the sense that the rule there, those days, was something a little different, and he was able to achieve this because he hit the ball out of the Adelaide Oval. So what was he the first batsman to do? A very simple thing, a very 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 common thing today in cricket, and especially in T20 cricket you see lots of this. Think simple, don't think very complicated. He hit the ball out of the ground. So, what do you think would have happened? And he did it twice more. And like I told you, something very common in cricket today and something that happens very often in T20 cricket.
So, maybe a new ball had to be arranged.
No, nothing to do with the new ball having to be arranged. Harshit?
He hit a six.
He hit a six. And what would the rule book back then ensured that he hit the first six?
So, the ball had to be hit out of the ground to be a six.
Absolutely right. That gets you the full 10 points, Harshit. Well done. In those days, the ball had to go out of the ground to be considered a six. So, these days, if it just goes beyond the boundary rope, you get a six. Those days, if it went along the ground to the boundary, it was a four. If it went beyond the boundary rope, you would get a five. And then you would get a 6 only if it went out of the ground, right? And it took 54 tests. Test cricket began in 1877 and it took 54 test matches before the first 6 was recorded because he hit the ball out of the ground. Excellent answer. 10 points to Harshit. Well done. Question comes to Harnoor. A journalist once told Pete Conrad that the words were all made up by the government. Conrad wanted to prove that this wasn't the case, and he told the journalist exactly what he was going to say and made a bet for $500 to prove that he was going to say it. Conrad was not a very tall man. He made good on his promise and said these words, "Whoopee, man, that may have been a small one for blank, but it's a long one for me." Who is Pete Conrad? He was the third man to achieve something. What was he the third man to do? And whose original quote was he alluding to when he said that may have been a small one for somebody, it's a long one for me?
So I think he was an astronaut, maybe.
Okay, he was an astronaut. Specifically, he was the third man to do what?
Maybe walk on the moon.
All right, and what was the original quote he was referencing? or whose original words was he talking about?
Neil Armstrong.
Neil Armstrong. That's good enough. Take your 10 points. He was the third person to walk on the moon. He was referring to Neil Armstrong's quote of "This is that's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind." So he said that may have been a small step for Neil, but it was a long step for me because I was not very tall. And there is of course this discussion that Neil Armstrong said that's one small step for a man, and that got cut out. So he was meaning that that's one small step for a man, one giant leap for mankind, became one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Good, Harnoor, 10 points to you. Harish, your question. Bertha von Suttner was the Nobel Peace Prize laureate in 1905. She was also associated with Alfred Nobel a few years before she was awarded the prize. The desk in the picture was used by people in a particular profession. What is such a desk called? And therefore, what was the relationship between Bertha von Suttner and Alfred Nobel? It's essentially only one answer. If you give one keyword, you will get both the name of the desk as well as what her profession was.
Is it a typist desk?
Typist desk. So, she was the typist for Alfred Nobel. Okay. Good guess. Not typist desk. Devanshu?
Was she the... like the one who gave the ideas, the colleague or scientist, professor kind of?
Professor. No, not professor. Passes to Arav.
She was a writer.
She was a writer. So this is called a writer's desk. Okay, good guess. Not writer. Passes to Suvansh.
I suppose it's a stenographer.
Stenographer.
The person. Not the person who, it's a typewriter desk, which he used to write. Yeah.
No, not stenographer. Passes to Sejal.
She was a novelist.
She was a novelist. And, okay.
And like she was a known friend of Alfred Nobel.
Friend of Alfred Nobel. Okay. She was a novelist. No, she was not a novelist. Passes to Ratandeep.
Sir, I believe this is an accountant's desk and she was the accountant of Alfred Nobel.
Okay, nice guess again. Not accountant's desk. Passes to Harshit.
It's a typewriter desk.
Typewriter desk. No, somebody already tried that. And the last pass to Harnoor.
Sir, she was like a close friend of Alfred.
Okay.
And I think she was a... Journalist.
Okay. So, she is a journalist desk. Okay. A lot of you came very close with typewriter, stenographer and so on. It's somebody who used to do all that and a bit more. Somebody who used to keep schedules. Somebody who used to plan.
PA. The personal assistant.
Not personal assistant, but very similar to that.
Secretary.
Secretary. Yes. This is called a secretary desk. And she worked for Alfred Nobel as his secretary. So, this is called a secretary desk. Right. I think with that, we have come to the last question of Pantomathics 2020. The grand finale over here, the inter-school quiz brought to you by St. Kabir Public School. Like I said, a virtual big round of applause to all our 8 contestants. A fantastic answering. You could see that barely one question in each round went unanswered, and that also with very good guesses. I mean, it shows that the spirit of curiosity and the spirit to know more and develop general knowledge. And if you have seen this quiz, it's not a standard general knowledge quiz. It is about putting various associations and things together. So that's a big round of applause to all our 8 contestants. Very good. Again, like I said at the end of the semi-final, does not matter where you finish over here. Even if you finished 8th, remember that you were a finalist and keep quizzing. The only way to get better at quizzing is to quiz more, right? So wonderful. It was my pleasure quizzing all of you. Thank you very, very much for being a part of this. Here is the last question and it goes direct to Devanshu. Scrabble was invented by an unemployed New York architect called Alfred Mosher Butts. after analyzing some of the games that were already on the market, he developed a game that included aspects of crossword puzzles and anagrams. There was also a bit of chance through randomly picked letters. Butts worked out the frequency and value of these letters by following an interesting, ingenious process. So, I'm sure all of you have played Scrabble and you would have seen that, you know, there are more tiles for some letters and less tiles for other letters, and also that they have different scores, right? On what basis did he come up with the frequency and value of the letters? What ingenious process did he adopt?
So, I really don't know the process, but I think I remember that there was written that A was 1, Z was 10.
Correct. How did he come up with this? So, in a typical Scrabble board, you will find, for example, a lot of E's, a lot of A's, but, you know, fewer Z's and fewer Q's and so on. How did he come up with how many of each to have and what value to give them? On what basis did he decide that? He did a very simple logical thing.
Sir, is it related with vowels?
I mean, yes, obviously there are more vowels and so on, but on what basis did he come up with that?
Yeah, I can't say. I just remember the numbers.
Okay, all right. No problem. Let's pass it on to Arav.
I guess he worked out the frequency by looking at the number of appearances of that word in a dictionary or encyclopedia.
Oh, in a dictionary or encyclopedia. Excellent guess. Excellent guess. Not correct. Dictionary or encyclopedia. Quiz is very tightly poised. So, Arav said by looking at the frequencies in the dictionary or encyclopedia, it passes to Suvansh.
I remember this, but I do not remember the specific process, but I think he saw the frequency the letters were used in the English language.
How in the, where in the, I mean, when you say English language, what did he refer to? Like Arab said, he referred to encyclopedias and dictionaries.
Yeah. He referred to, so it's a specific book, right? He must have referred.
What was his specific source?
His specific source was the Oxford Dictionary.
The Oxford Dictionary. Nope, not the Oxford Dictionary. I would have given it for dictionary in that case. Sejal?
He came up with the frequency by, you know, determining how much, like, a letter is used in daily conversation, in like normal conversation. The rarer the letter, the lesser its frequency. Okay. The more we use a letter, such as,
How did he get hold of these daily conversations? As in, he went around asking people what words they use more commonly. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting guess. Very good guess, but not correct. Sorry. We'll pass you on to Ratandeep.
My original guess would have been the dictionary as well, but since that is wrong, I'll say that he checked the frequency in the newspapers.
In the newspapers, that's absolutely correct. So, he looked at, so the most common source for the written word, Sejal was on the right track, but it was not oral conversation. He had to check how frequently these letters appeared in a written word. So, the best
source... But it was on the front page of the New York Times.
He referred to like various newspapers, did an analysis and found that, you know, these were the words and therefore the letters that occurred most frequently in the newspaper. And that's how he came up with the frequencies. Excellent answer. So, Ratandeep answered that. So, he gets 10 points. And that brings us to the end of the quiz. I have no idea which way the scores have gone, so it's going to be an interesting surprise for us to look at it. Who's going to get 5,100? Who's going to get 3,100? Who's going to get 2,100? All right. So, great. Very close. So, we have Arav Verma at 15 points in 8th place. In joint 5th place, we have three contestants, Devanshu Setia, Harish and Harnoor Kaur, all with 20 points. In fourth place, we have Harshit with 25 points, with a couple of excellent answers towards the end and winning himself 2100 rupees. In third place is Ratandeep Singh Poor. So a round of applause to you, Ratandeep. Very well done. And in an absolute photo finish, very, very close, and both of them have been neck and neck throughout the quiz. I think right from question one, looking at the scores, we find that our runner-up for today is Sejal Trehan with 65 points. And our champion in the first inaugural edition of Pantomatics 2020 is Suvansh Mahajan from St. Kabir Public School with 70 points. Couldn't have asked for a closer finish. Great show from all of you, and a very warm round of congratulations and applause to all 8 contestants. St. Kabir team will reach out to you. You will get your trophies, you will get your certificates. The winners will of course get their prizes and so on. So it's been my absolute pleasure to host this quiz. Before I hand it over to Deepta from St. Kabir, I'd like to call out a few people. My colleagues, Venkatraman is here in the studio with me helping out, but there's also a big content team at the back end with Hatim Syed Mohammed, the content team led by Rishikesh Verma, and my co-founder Vivek Karthikeyan, who have all helped put these wonderful questions together that you're all seeing right now through the semi-finals and the finals. Also, a special round of thanks and a shout out to the team Audio Plus, who are our technology vendors, who have put this wonderful virtual show together. They are our technology audiovisual partners. And of course, my personal thanks to the St. Kabir team, to Mr. Gurpreet Bakshi and the rest of the management team, the principal, Lieutenant Colonel Ratanbir Singh. And of course, a very special round of thanks to a dear friend of mine and a wonderful quizzer herself, Deepta. All right, Deepta, over to you.
Thank you so much, Venki, and good afternoon to all of you. Wow, what a fantastic 2 days of quizzing it's been. Sundays and quizzing are made for each other. At least that's how it was when I was in school. And so it was wonderful to relive that feeling. So on behalf of our founder, Mr. JP Singh, the management and everyone in St. Kabir, I want to thank all the participants for giving us such high quality quizzing over the last 2 days. It was wonderful to see how you worked out the answers and really pushed yourselves to get that extra 5 points, and what a close finish. So congratulations to the winners and everyone who participated. I also have to thank the various school heads who have nominated their very best for this first edition of Pantomatics and for giving it just the kind of start that we hoped for. Although we would have loved for it to be a real quiz in person, but this is exactly where Venki and the team at Nexus pulled no stops in ensuring that we will do this digitally and we will do it very well. So thank you, Venki, and everyone at Nexus. Really heartfelt thanks to all of you. And finally, my personal thanks to Mrs. Chadda, our chief advisor, our co-scholastics advisor, Sneha Vadwa, and the team of student coordinators who have reached out to all of you personally to ensure that you got all your information and that, you know, you didn't miss out on anything before you could log in. So that's really all that I have to say. I'm just so happy that we've started off this big, you know, event, and hope that this is going to become a marquee event in our school calendar. And we really hope that we can take it to the national level, of course, with Venki and the team at Nexus. So thank you all so much.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you so much, Deepta, for those very nice words. And yeah, a special shout out to the St. Kabir student volunteers. I'm sure it must have been a fun project for all of them to handle this, and things seem to have gone very smoothly. So thank you all very much. Perhaps we should just hear from the contestants once, a quick word on what they felt in this new digital format of quizzing, and how they enjoyed the whole thing. So let's have all our contestants very, very quickly talk about their experiences of this quiz. Let's go in the same order. Is Arav there?
Yes, hi. So my experience has been great with this quiz. Like, I have not really participated in quizzing before, but this really like will motivate me to participate more in quizzing. And I learned a lot throughout the course of these 2 days. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Arav, and well done to you. Devanshu, would you like to say a few words?
Yeah, I think this quiz just reminded me a lot of the last quiz that I had on the Dell platform.
Okay.
The Dell quiz that happened, I think, last year. The same thing happened also, that we choked in the finals. At the top six contestants, the same thing happened now. But yes, I got to learn a lot that I didn't know before.
Doesn't matter at all. I think if you are in more finals, then the better it is for you. You obviously keep increasing your chances of winning. So well done. Harish?
As on the first day, I mentioned that I am here for learning, not winning. So this quiz has given me one of the greatest learnings of my life, that there will be some days when you will be on the top and some days when you will be not. So it is all of the part of the life. So we should accept it and learn from each experience. Thank you very much to the St. Kabir School from the side of Sacred Art School and the Nexus Consultancy for creating this great moment.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very wise words from Harish. Thank you very much. Harnoor, how was your experience? And
my experience, it was a great one. It was a very different quiz. And indeed, the questions put up in this quiz were very interesting. And I would like to thank St. Kabir School for organizing such a quiz.
Thank you. Thank you, Harnoor. Now we go to Harshit.
This was my first experience with an online quiz. It was very well planned and it was really intense and competitive. Hats off to the organizers for organizing this.
Thank you. Thank you, Harshit. Thank you. And now we go to our bronze medalist for today, Ratandeep Singh Puar.
Yes, so this has been quite an engaging and fun learning experience. I did not expect the type of questions that came, but it was quite a pleasant surprise and I just really enjoyed it on the whole.
Thank you, Ratandeep. Excellent answers and congratulations on finishing third. Our runner-up for Pantomathics 2020, Sejal Trehan.
Okay, so first of all, I would like to congratulate St. Kabir Public School and Nexus for hosting this quiz wonderfully. And I know how hard it can be, especially on an online platform. Like St. Kabir School made sure they called us and made sure we received the email, so that was commendable. And also the quality of the questions, they were very intriguing and they were so fun. And I've learned so much in this quiz. And I also learned that there is so much more that I need to know. And that has only encouraged me to want to learn more. And I also believe that all my other competitors, they also did amazingly well. I was very surprised at certain answers that were given by the participants when I was completely overwhelmed by the questions. And thank you to everyone.
Thank you. And very, very well played with some wonderful answers and very, very close finish. A minor answer here or there, then and you could have actually won the quiz. But fantastic. And I'm particularly gladdened, and I know that Deepta is also a very strong proponent of this, that girls and women should be much more active in quizzing. So very good to see that we made a start at least with two of our 8 finalists being girls, and one of them is on the podium as a runner-up. So excellent. And our champion, Suvansh Mahajan.
So good afternoon, everyone. Nexus quizzes are always top-notch level in terms of quizzing, in terms of management, and I've done quite a lot of these now, and it's not surprising to see the questions now, but the curiosity, the excitement gets way more hype before, because you already know the questions are gonna be this excellent, and the amazing thing about these questions is that you do not have to remember anything, or you do not have to know much to know these answers. All you have to do is basically read the question over and over. Before, what my focus used to be with these quizzes was that I would rack my brain and thinking about what the most unobvious, what the most obvious answer or what strictly GK regime answer would be, but then you realize that it's just common sense in some of these questions, like that candy question yesterday, and most of the questions today were of this format. So it was fun as always, and I'm excited to do more of the quizzes with the Nexus, and I'm ready to participate next year as well. I hope this is going to be much more bigger next year. So thanks everyone.
Excellent. Next year, I presume you will be in college, so you can come and help us out in possibly conducting the quiz
when we
depending on where you are. And congratulations once again to you. Alright, so on that note, take care, stay home, stay safe. The pandemic is still not gone away, so don't be careless around that. Wash your hands, maintain your distance, wear your mask, stay safe, stay healthy, and keep quizzing, and we will soon see you at another quiz. This is Venki on behalf of Nexus and St. Kabir Public School saying bye-bye to all of you. Bye-bye.